Good morning. So it's a real pleasure to be here, and I hope I can drive you into computational astrochemistry. My understanding is that only a few of you are really involved in chemical modeling. So please interrupt me if you don't understand. If you have a question, I would be very happy to answer. I already introduced myself, so I'm working on magnetic dynamical simulation, all kind of models, from 0D to 3D, stuff for the regions, gaps, information, evolution. And I'm also interested in the laboratory astrochemistry and theoretical chemistry. So today, as I said, I'm starting to introduce you to computational astrochemistry. And first of all, I'm very happy that yesterday this John, Mike, Susanna introduced you the basic of astrochemistry, so this helps me a lot. And today I'm going to talk about the computational aspect of this very nice discipline. Okay, I will repeat some of the concepts just to make clear the important point. So this is the definition of astrochemistry already given by John yesterday, more or less. So astrochemistry is actually what is bridging the gap between microphysics and macrophysics. So we want to understand how chemical processes affect the formation of stars, planets, and gas. There's another definition which I like a lot, which is tell us more about the multidisciplinary approach to astrochemistry, which is this definition by Alex Delgado. So astrochemistry is a blending of astronomy and chemistry, where each area enriches the other in a mutually stimulating interaction. It's even more than that, because astrochemistry is very, very multidisciplinary. Involves spectroscopy, molecular physics, chemical kinetics, surface sciences, particle chemistry, astronomy, cosmology, numerics, and recently also biology with the branch of astrobiology, which is now a pretty hot topic. I have to say that not always all these branches of science talk to each other. This is one of the problems of astrochemistry. But when they talk, you can do really, really good stuff, and we have a lot of progress in astrochemistry. This is another slide which reminds to John's slide yesterday. So astrochemistry exists since the first atoms and molecule formed, more or less 100,000 years after the Big Bang, and so it was more or less, this is a very simple environment with very few species, very few molecules. Also, in terms of physical processes, it's not so complicated. So it's a kind of test case for astrochemistry, for computational astrochemistry. Of course, when the first star formed and died, the medium was enriched by metals and dust grains, so also the chemistry became more complex. And we know today, at least when we move to the local universe, that the chemistry is pretty complex. We observe a lot of complex molecules. We observe food and sugar are solvable. So, and you can understand that depending on what kind of environment you want to simulate, the chemistry complexity is increasing. So you go from simple chemistry with very few reactions to something where you have to include isotopes, spin state chemistry, and so it becomes very, very complex. So this is a sketch. We show the different branches of astrochemistry. So we have heard a bit about laboratory astrochemistry, theoretical chemistry yesterday evening, and we will hear some about observational astrochemistry from Susanne. And today I'm focusing on computational astrochemistry. All these branches are very well connected because, first of all, laboratory studies and theoretical studies provide all the atomic and molecular data that we use to interpret, for instance, observation. And we also need this data, like collision coefficients, reactive or inelastic, for modeling. And computational astrochemistry is also, the aim of computational astrochemistry is actually to interpret observations. So also computational astrochemistry and observational astrochemistry are very, very well connected. Now, okay, some additional definition of computational astrochemistry, the word I already say a lot, so it's the computational part of astrochemistry, which means that we use computational tool to understand or to interpret the observation. So it's not only that, because there are models which are tuned on observation, but there are also a priori models which aim to understand basic physical processes. For instance, if you want to study star formation and the effect of turbulence in magnetic fields on the density evolution and how these affect the chemistry, so this can be called a priori models. Of course, we always have to face with the reality, so we always try to compare with observations, but it is not always straightforward. I want to stress also that nowadays computational astrochemistry converged into computational astrophysics because we are able to perform three-dimensional aerodynamical simulation with chemistry. So when we talk about computational astrochemistry, we also refer to computational astrophysics. Now, a bit of history. Yesterday, Mike introduced, gave a bit of history of astrochemistry. So we started to observe the first molecule moving to tertiary in the 40s, like CH, CN, CH+. But then the question is, when computational astrochemistry, when the first models started to be developed? It is more or less around the same time. So by Kramers, Bates, and Spitzer, want to understand to interpret the observation of this molecule. So the first model given this paper, which is called Condensation in Interstellar Space by Kramers in 46, and then another paper by Bates and Spitzer titled The Density of Molecules in Interstellar Space. So, and this is what we can see in these papers. This is more or less this kind of sketch that now are quite often used, and this is the first time that we could see this kind of sketch, or this graph about chemical networks. So, just to explain quickly, what this is telling us is that C plus is forming CH plus through this reaction regulated by this ring coefficients alpha, which is actually this 10 to minus 17. It's a typical rate equation you can write down. So they, in this paper, they built this simple chemical network to explain the formation of CH and CH+. And this is the paper by Bates and Spitzer. They did something similar. They built chemical networks, and you see here the rate coefficients. And they set up some equilibrium equation to, again, to calculate the abundance of CH and CH+. Now, what are the aim of astrochemistry, or what we want to, what kind of answer we want to give? So, what we are trying to do is to actually to explain the chemical diversity we observe, and how molecule can be used as a physical diagnostic of the object we observe. And this is also, as I said, there is a branch of astrochemistry, how do molecules in space relate to life, as we know. Now, we know that the matter we can observe is only 5%. So, and it's very different from what we expect, what we know in our planet. So this is a table, also Mike showed this yesterday. And this is the periodic table for astronomers again. So the composition of the universe of the interstellar medium is 98% of hydrogen helium and 2% of metals and dust. So and the question is, this was one of the first questions astrophysicists ask themselves, how this simple element can lead to the formation of a complex molecule. So why we observe this chemical complexity, if the condition, the physical condition are very different from what we know in there, and also the composition, the chemical composition is so different. just as a reminder, these are more or less the condition that you expect in the interstellar medium. So it's a very harsh environment. You have a large range of temperature, density. Density is pretty low, by the way, compared to what we have in our atmosphere. And then this is the reason why the chemistry of the interstellar medium is mostly driven by two-body reactions. And as John said yesterday, we are far from equilibrium. In any case, we observe more than 200 molecules. So this condition, in some way, are able to favor the formation of a complex molecule. And these are 200, but without considering, for instance, the isotope that we observe. Now, so again, some basic comments. So these are great questions that we will see a lot when we will talk about computational astrochemistry. So these are the bricks of chemical modeling. And these are just three simple examples that where you see actually the rate question describes the evolution in time of a given species. And this is regulated by the formation and structure of the ocean. And here you can see a typical antibody reaction. It's a unimolecular reaction involving a photon. And you sometimes if the density are pretty high, you can have also three-body reaction. And this is how you build up this rate equation. Actually, it depends on the rate coefficients, which is one of the big uncertainties of chemical model. And then, of course, it depends on the density of the reactor. Okay, so chemistry generally is out of equilibrium, regulated by two-body reaction. And but overall, it's very complex. And the way how we measure the evolution of the species is through rate equation. So rate equation again are the bricks of chemical modeling. Now, the question is why, if we have this beautiful observation, we need chemical models? Because building chemical models required, it's challenging. So, if we have observation, why we need chemical models? So observations, of course, are very powerful, provide a lot of information, but are also very powerful. But unfortunately, they only provide information on a single snapshot in time. So I look at this image and say, okay, this is the current stage of this object. I can know about density, temperature, and other information, but I don't know how this object formed or how this object will evolve. So to know that, I need to build chemical models. Same for the chemistry. I can observe tracers with a given abundance, with a given column density, but I don't know how this abundance has been reached. What are the main processes which leads to the formation of this specific tracer? So, and this is why we need modeling, which provide actually information about the evolution of the object prior and after the observed stage. So, this is an important slide because. I will use this to introduce the different models that we have in astrochemistry. So we have to distinguish about different things. So when we talk about chemistry, usually we refer to chemical processes, kinetics, networks. And there are models which usually are built to evolve chemical networks. You just follow the time evolution of the chemical networks, fixing the density and temperature, right, without caring too much about the physics. Of course, you can run a lot of these models. As Susanna yesterday said, that you can run 1,000 models easily because these are not so expensive. And they can help you, at least quite clearly, to understand what's going on. Then there is microphysics. And this is whatever concern what's happening at a small scale. So quantum chemistry is involved. So, and this means cooling, heating, gas-dust interaction with the radiation, and you are physicist, chemist, so you know what we mean about cooling, but I will talk about how we model cooling tomorrow. And then, on top of this, there is macrophysics. Macrophysics is what is regulated by aerodynamics, by classical physics, and involved turbulence, magnetic fields. So, in principle, you can build simple chemical models, or you can build models where you also follow the microphysics, which means you follow the thermal evolution or the interaction with the radiation and matter, radiation and dust. And on top of that, you can couple all this chemistry and microphysics with macrophysics. And these are actually three-dimensional models with chemistry, which are very expensive usually. So this is where we have to cut the reaction of the chemistry we involve to be able to perform in the simulation. So this again just to stress the different model we can build. So historically, I mean, because of also the computational power was not so, I mean, we didn't have the computational power to build a three-dimensional simulation with chemistry, so most of the models were developed in an iterative fashion. What does it mean? Again, I fixed the density, the temperature, I fixed a series of physical parameters, and I evolved the chemistry in time. This is more or less what we mean for theory model, and the goal is to understand what are the most important processes. So usually this is largely used by observers to understand what they observe. So they fix the properties, I mean they observe the forming regions, they know the density, the temperature, so they fix this parameter and then they evolve the chemistry in time. And so they, you can study a lot of what are the main processes which lead to the formation of specific tracer. And then we have complex model, three-dimensional, so this involves you need a lot of computational power. You have to solve the question of motion, and sometimes you have to couple with radiative transfer, which is per se super expensive. And you want to include perhaps magnetic fields, turbulence. So, and if you put chemistry on top of that, everything becomes very complex. But these are, I would say, more realistic models. Of course, chemistry is limited, but still you have all the physics in place. Okay, today I will start going into the chemistry, how we model chemistry, what are the caveats, what are the problems, what is, why it's challenging to model chemistry, what are the uncertainties. So first of all, now that we know that we need models to explain what we observe, we have also to justify why we want to include chemistry in, for instance, in numerical simulation. So I said you want to study star formation. Star formation is mainly regulated by cooling, and cooling is provided by molecules. So if you want to properly model star forming regions, you need to include the proper chemical models and the proper microphysics. So it means cooling, heating, dust. So this is the main reason that actually led us to include chemistry in aerodynamic simulation. Of course, chemistry is not easy, but it's troublesome because it's, we will see that it's very CPU demanding. It has a nonlinear behavior, and building chemical networks, which is the first step to build chemical models, is very challenging. And in addition, as I show here, chemistry is linked with microphysics. So everything becomes more challenging. Now, mathematically speaking, we have to solve a system of order and differential equation, first order, where again you see the evolution of the species in time depends on formation and destruction rates. So very simple kinetics, and when you couple chemistry with microphysics, you want also to follow the thermal evolution, and this depends on cooling and heating. And as you see here, the cooling and the heating function depends on density and temperature. So when the temperature changes, you are changing the grade coefficients. Then you are changing the density, and then you change again the cooling and the heating function. So everything is super connected, and this should be solved altogether. And in addition, the problem of chemical models, or the problem of this rate equation, is that these are the system of order and differential equations that are so called stiff. Stiff, it means that some of the solution are reached very easily, while other components are very slow in conversion. So you need an appropriate solver to solve this rate equation. So this is just an example of a simple chemical network with two reactions, and this is how you will write down the rate equation, and some, and this is the Jacobian. Jacobian is the derivative of some variables toward other variables. So why I'm introducing the Jacobian? Because actually the Jacobian is needed when you use solvers for a stiff equation. Now, okay, the first problem is then the stiffness of this equation. Stiffness is a phenomenon which was introduced or discovered during the 50s when people realized that for some of these rate equations was very difficult to converge. with a standard explicit solver. And as I said, there were components of this system which were converting very fast, while other components were very slow. And they also were realizing this by the failure of the explicit Runge group methods. So the definition then of stiffness, as of course there are different definitions. But as I said, one of the definitions that you have, while you vary in time scales, again, some of the components converge easily and other components are very slow. And this means that your step size is dictated by stability requirement rather than accuracy. And this is very bad. And then what we need is specific solver, which are implicit, so-called implicit solver, to solve the equation. So just a reminder, what is an explicit method? Is a method where you plug in the solution, the end solution, and then you obtain the end plus one. So it's a typical single step method, very easy, very simple. So each new time step computational is considered as a new initial value problem. Okay? And these are the methods which actually do not work when we want to solve chemical networks or rate equation related to chemical networks in astrochemistry. So we need the implicit methods, and usually you look, this is a typical PDL method. And as you see, it depends, solution of n plus 1 depends also from this function, which is evaluated at the n plus 1. So it's an algebraic equation which should be solved with proper methods. And these methods are usually requires the Jacobian. And calculating the Jacobian is very expensive. And you have also to use specific method to solve this algebraic equation. Method like Newton methods or Prevost. I don't know how much you are into computational methods, but this is actually not a typical method you use to solve for that are used in implicit solving. So this is again the Jacobian, but I already showed you an example. So usually these kind of solvers calculate the Jacobian, and they are specific methods to solve the equation. And these methods are usually Newton or Prevost methods. I'm not going into the details also because I'm not an expert of solvers, but if you ask me, I can give you some material, or you can look easily online how this method works. I will skip this, but quickly, why these methods are very powerful, because they have usually an adaptive step size, which is pretty good when you have to handle this stiff system. And they can also be variable in the order of the solver. So higher the order, usually more accurate is the solution. But of course, it can be more expensive. There's another important features of astrochemical networks, which is the so-called sparsity. What is sparsity? Sparsity is when most of your elements in the Jacobian matrix are zero. So most of the astrochemical networks actually are very sparse. 80-90% of this Jacobian matrix is zero. Then you need a specific solver which can handle with sparsity if you want to speed up the solution. Of course, when you work with low dimensionality models, you don't care too much about that, because you can run these models quite quickly. But when you want to work with two-dimensional simulation, it can take weeks, months, and you want to be fast, you want to optimize your algorithm. So, and just to give you an example, a few years ago, we showed that actually when you use a solvers which can handle with sparsity, you can have a speed up to 100, for instance, and this is pretty a lot. Okay, now this was very quick. I mean, this is a very technical approach to the astrochemical networks. Yeah?
Stefan, the speed up is two orders of magnitude, is nice, but can you give some idea of the actual time?
Okay. Right, time depends on the chemical network, on the model you run, if it's 0D, 1D, 3D.
Just use your favorite one.
But in this case, I mean, in this paper, we run a one-dimensional model with a shock, very simple shock. And I guess normally something will take 5-6 minutes, something of 10 minutes, and then you have a speed up a lot if you change the solver. Of course, there are other tricks you can use. For instance, as you can calculate the rate coefficients, and this will speed up also the computation.
So it's not the lifetime of graduate school.
No, but yeah, under factor of 100 in a simulation of 1 month is a lot.
Yeah.
Now, the second problem now is the network complexity. Again, this depends on what kind of problem you want to build. Usually, we represent networks through graphs, and where the nodes are the chemical species, and the edges are actually represent the reaction. And you see that actually I showed before the graph from Kramer's in the 40s, which already looked pretty complex, but you can have an even more complex network. So more species you include, more reaction you include, more complex becomes the network, more difficult and more stiff becomes your problem. And this is why when we work with three-dimensional simulation, we want to keep the number of species at minimum necessary to understand the chemistry or to solve the thermodynamics. Okay, this is an example. This is a network for CO formation from Yali 2015. And again, just for you to take use of this kind of sketch. Again, this represents the actual like HCO plus electron here, which is associated recombination is providing, is producing CO. So this is the way how you read this kind of sketch. So you omit usually some of the products or the reactant. But here, for instance, CH2 plus reacting with H2 is forming CH2 plus, and so on. So you can build this chemical network sketch, which are very useful sometimes to understand in which direction your network is going. Which are the main species? Like in this case, you can see that. Of course, you can see that CS plus for CO, but there are other cases where you can really identify what are the main hubs of your chemical network, so which is useful. Now I want to do a simple experiment. This is what you can have in a normal case. You have a lot of atoms, molecules, you can have isomer, isotopes, and fancy stuff, whether it's pH or something like that. And you have a lot of different chemical processes, which were introduced yesterday by Susanna. But let's do a simple experiment. Let's select just hydrogen, H minus and H plus, and only three types of reaction. And let's see what is the network that we will end up. Of course, chemical reaction commutes, so it means that this reaction is the same as this. So we look only at the half of the matrix. And we have to remove all the impossible combination in terms of chemistry. So H minus plus H minus is not going to happen. So I remove all this kind of combination. And when you build a chemical network, if you have three, four species, whatever is not belonging to this set of species is not part of your network. So reaction which form H2 should be removed. In this case. So until we end up with this few reactions, which are 10 or less, and you have all kinds of reactions, with ionization, radiative attachment, photoionization, cosmic ionization. So we selected three types of reaction, and we ended up with 10 reactions. This will be our chemical. So you now can imagine if we start to add more species and more reaction, how this network will diverge. So this is just to tell you that building chemical network is pretty complex, and chemical network can diverge very quickly and easily. Yeah.
So for the cosmic ray ionization or detachment, do you simulate it with proton collision?
Actually, cosmic rays are you use this kind of a pre-integrated or analytical rate. models. And there are no people modeling cosmic rays.
For this network,
yeah,
from sort of the amalgam of calculations and the observation.
Now, this is just an example of what kind of set of reaction you can build from starting from pretty simple species.
Right.
And of course, you include the cosmic rays, which are usually treated in a simple way in models. Of course, you can build more complex
right.
models where you can follow the propagation of cosmic rays, but this is very rare. So, perhaps tomorrow, when I introduce the model, the how we model this inside and show you how we model it. It's very, very, very simple and nothing special. Yeah. Now, to summarize, what we have seen is that, of course, okay, chemical networks or chemical models are start by building a chemical network so that you can build your rate equation, and you need a proper solver to solve the system or the differential equation. And this solver usually are implicit solver, yeah, high order PDF or other kind of solvers. Chemical networks can be complex, but there is another problem, which is the accuracy and the availability of the rates. You are chemists and physicists, so you work on calculating rate coefficients of different processes, so you know how difficult it is to provide rate coefficients for systems which are larger than a diatom, atom, or electron diatom, if we talk about quantum chemistry. So there is then the problem of accuracy of the rates, how much we trust the rates which are provided by the community. And I have to say that most people use rates blindly, so they don't know too much particular astronomers. So they just take whatever is provided. And this is one problem. And we have also problem of availability of rates and how to retrieve the rates. So there are databases that can be used, but I will show you. So you have to be very careful with databases. So, the third problem of modeling chems is rate accuracy and availability. And again, the problem is to evaluate these rate coefficients, which goes into the rate equation, and how we determine usually the rate coefficients. You know this, we can do experimentally. If we are lucky, we can study reactions in laboratory at the temperature of interest for astrochemical, for astronomical regions. I guess Susanna yesterday showed that you can use Langevin, right? You show that because it's easy to evaluate the Langevin rate. But of course you have to be very careful also with the Langevin. It works for ion molecules and for exothermic reaction and provides usually temperature independent rates, but there is also a version of the Langevin where you can introduce temperature dependence. But I would say that most of the rates probably when you use these super huge networks, are probably Langevin or very rough estimate, and this is one of the problems. Sometimes people do physical consideration. They say, okay, I have the rates for my epigenetic species. I can do some rescaling by mass for the theoretical version, and I know how much this is reliable. And okay, the best would be to perform ignition computation or quantum chemistry, but we know that it is not possible with the solving Schrödinger question for large system is very difficult, so we have to rely on a statistical method, semi-classical method, and we know that this method can fail when we move to low temperature. Okay, I will show you an example of one of the well-maintained databases, one of the most used databases, together with, this. The UMIST and the also are still used. So the difference is it has a catchy interface. So it looks more modern, but in the end, the information it contains are very similar to other databases. So now, this is the KIDA web page. You can play with KIDA in the afternoon if you like, or in the future. Usually you write down the reaction area and you get information about the rates, and the rates are usually written in this way. So saying this is the way how we calculate the cosmic rate ionization There's an alpha which depends on the species you are considering, and then there's the cosmic deionization rate, where we don't know anything about this number. So from observation, of course, in diffuse cloud, we have observation of H3 plus, and you can derive the cosmic deionization rate. But when you move to dense clouds, this is strongly model dependent. So this number can vary by order of magnitude. And there are cases where cosmic rays affect the chemistry a lot. And so if you change by a factor of two, your final conclusion will change. So the cosmic ray ionization rate is another big uncertainty we have in models. And we quite often we forget about that. So I think we always need to keep in mind the caveats, the uncertainties that we have in models. Okay, this is the way how the rates are fitted in the Chile database, and there is also some suggestion about the reliability of the rates, if this is skewed, if this is recommended. If we don't know anything about the rate, probably in this case you have probably a simple estimate. And yeah, you see, for instance, this is one case where you have all this reaction for oxygen, probably. I typed into the website, and you see that you have the reaction, the coefficients, which refer to this, some of this formula, and you can add the rates that you can apply into your models. Now, just one example, but I'm sure there are many of these examples. You take one rate from the Chile, and this is the mutual neutralization of H+. And then if you dig into literature yourself, you find the best. If you know about quantum chemistry, you can distinguish between good rates and bad rates. And then if you take this, like this is a fit provided by Fernand, I guess it comes from some quantum chemistry calculation. And then you see the ratio between these rates and the Chile one is not one. So it means that there's a problem here. It means that the Chile is providing sometimes, in some cases, rates which are not the state of the art. This is my experience. And another problem that we have in Chile is that most of the rates are provided in a very limited range of temperature. So you have rates between 10 and 300 K, but if you study environments where you need to explore higher temperature, if you study galaxy formation, you can go up to 10^5 K or 1000 K. So you miss this information, and this is very risky. So you have always to double check the rates that you find in databases. And this is my personal advice. I can say that I spend half of my working time in actually building chemical networks, because you need to dig into literature, check the rates, check the behavior. So the larger the networks, more difficult is problem. Of course, you can still take blindly what you find online, but it's up to you. Okay, so we have now set the basic problem, which is only this chemistry part. Tomorrow we will talk about microphysics, and you already see how many uncertainties we have only on the chemistry side. And this is one of the problems I can come on. So, but what you have to do normally is when you have set your rate equation, you can add for rate coefficients, and then you can develop your solver to solve this equation or use some public code, and then you can check your results. Checking the results is another problem of our community. It seems that we don't like too much benchmarking, and this is where the other half of my time is spent in benchmarking, because I guess it's very important. So when you develop something new, you always code or a new chemical network, or if you want to study new reactions or new processes, you always have to show you are able to benchmark your code towards other codes. And this is quite often not the case in astrophysics. So this is a sketch just to show you the complexity again. Chemistry is one part, and then we have all the rest, which is the microphysics. So chemistry is connected to radiation, to dust, to cooling and heating processes. And we will see that all these processes that we call microphysics affect affect the temperature of the gas. Then if you work with aerodynamics and you change the temperature because of microphysics, it means that you have to couple your aerodynamics with the chemistry. And we will see some example tomorrow. So, yeah, I think this is all for today. And tomorrow we will go into some of these processes and we'll show you how we implement this in chemical models. And I will show you some example going from 0D to 3D and how to couple chemistry and aerodynamics. So if you have any questions, please, you're welcome. I don't know how much.
Benchmarking a code, are there certain reactions that you use that are really well studied?
There are, fortunately, we have papers or work which have been published with that you can use as a benchmark, that you trust because of being benchmarked so many times, you can reuse.
Okay. Which reactions?
It's not the reaction. I mean, if you develop a code which it depends on the problem you are handling, you are taking.
Can you build in the chemical network? How do you decide where to stop? You just keep going, and you're trying to figure out how others react.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, there are two approaches here. Or you do blindly, as if you do 0D models, you take whatever. There are people who use 10,000 reactions. And I doubt this is quite robust. But still, there are people publishing this paper with 20,000 reactions. I mean, I'm not criticizing, it's just a different approach. It's good that you can explore all these reactions in a simple code, because it's the only way where you can do this. But when you work with 3D stuff, you have to place some limit to what you want to include. An example that I can give you is when you model molecular clouds, where CO actually is the main chemical species you have to keep into account. I mean, what you want to do is to include the basic chemistry which affect the thermodynamics. The gas temperature is what is affecting the dynamics. So yeah, we will see tomorrow the temperature and the energy question in the dynamics. So once you have built a network which is able to reproduce reasonably the thermodynamic evolution, then you can say, okay, I will stop here. Yeah. Still, you have to test benchmark and be sure that it's worked. Yeah. It's problem with that. Yeah.
Interesting your equation for stiffness. So you're finding that eigenvalues of the Jacobian of F, but I didn't hear whether F is the temperature evolution equation or the rate equation, or is it something else? The function F.
So the Jacobian, yeah, you mean if you need the Jacobian for the temperature?
It's the Jacobian of F. Is F the temperature evolution equation? Is F the rate equation that you're looking at? What is this?
I showed you before what we mean for Jacobian. I mean, the problem, the Jacobian for the temperature is one of the problems we quite often have. Let's say that, I'm not an expert of solvers, but usually when you use this solver, like the Bode, the Sundial package, like Bode, Linfield solids, they all include methods to evaluate the Jacobian. You can also provide your Jacobian if you want. User provides Jacobian, but this is not always the case. But this example I made is just the Jacobian of the chemistry part. But you also have the Jacobian for the temperature. I don't know if this is your question.
So you just showed a general case, because while all the elements in your Jacobian are partials of F, I wanted to know what F is, the starting point you would need to know. What is function F, or what is it? Do you see what I mean?
You say half.
F, the letter, F, the function.
I don't have the question how this problem are solved, but where's the solver now? This F usually contains this polynomial stuff which you use to solve for the algebraic equation, but Now, I mean, going into the all the Jacobian and the Hesper later, I really like the article to dig into the code.
And just that last part.
So if I understood your question, I guess it's not so easy to answer. Yeah. So I should dig into the solver to see how this is usually how the Jacobian is solved. I cannot provide now you a method or something, some equation to know how this is related to that.
Okay.
But I can point you to some papers.
Okay.
I mean, the solver topic is something which is not, it's pretty challenging.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the time we use the solver as a black box. This is another problem.
Okay. Yes. Could be starting point, you would need to know the form of F in order to be able to use the Jacobian in the first place.
Yeah, you know F. I mean, if you use the BDF method, you have all this F, which is, can go to from first order to sixth order. You have this polynomial, but you know the form of F.
Okay, it's a polynomial.
Oh, this is the question.
Oh, it's a polynomial. Okay.
Yeah. No, you know. It depends on the method. You know how F is.
Okay.
What is the functional form of F?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. I have a two-part question. So it sounds like the reactions are all hard-coded in these chemicals. Is that right here?
In which, it depends in which chemical modes.
I don't know if that's a typical.
Okay, typical codes, I mean, there are not too many public codes, but now we tend to automatize the build-up of the rate equation. So usually, at least what we do with a PROM, which is our code, you have a Python script which reads the chemical network and build the rate equation automatically. It's not a hard code. So this reduces a lot the errors you can do.
Okay. Yeah,
but I know that all codes or all style codes, they have really hard code the rate equation.
No, I guess I was wondering if there's a way that you different
atoms, right? And then if you put in the
initial
like,
set of molecules,
and
then can the
computer just generate
how
the
reaction reacts with
each other? Is that what I'm actually doing? So some of us are here saying, well, these are. No. Okay, the example I show is just to make how easy you can diverge when you put the chemical network. You don't do that. And usually you take from the databases or from literature, you take a set of reaction rates that you want to include in your model, and then you build your rate equation. It's not that you start from scratch. You say, okay, I have this species now. I want to build my network. I do random coupling of the species. No, you already know what are the reaction means. You can look into databases or in the score.
Any more questions?
the field of computational astrochemistry, how many groups are there? So like, I know Susanna mentioned that they do some modeling, but how many computational astrochemistry groups are there that are specializing in computational astrochemistry?
That's a good question. I guess there are many people using chemical models. There are few people developing new models. And I will show you some more, but there are very, very, very few groups doing, for instance, chemistry in aeronautics that we can count on the on one end. And one of these is Simon, which was one of the first. Simon Global.
I would say there are about a dozen groups that are doing astrochemical modeling around the globe.
Yeah. So doing development is it's not so easy in this one. But there are a few groups doing that, and many groups using this model. This is my experience. Yeah.
Okay, but you mentioned that one of the codes are private, right? So is there a push to change that and make more open source?
Yeah, that's another good question. All good questions today. the critical question.
You're stuck with good questions.
The public, yeah. So releasing a code, like an open source code, or publicly releasing a code, is something that we still don't do too much in astrochemistry. I mean, I will mention some of the codes which are available publicly, but we are trying to change this. We are going to the direction to make public everything. This is what we do with Chrome. Chrome comes public. Of course, you can have a lot of bugs, but it's good. If more people use the code, more you can debug your code. If you use private code, you publish something. I have to say again, it's not like, I'm not criticizing, but most of people who publish chemical models, they don't provide the details. So if you want to benchmark, this is crazy. So you really have to contact the people, or you have just to spend to interpret what is in between the lines of the papers. And this is really, really difficult. And I have personal cases where I ask for help or for data that were missing in the paper, and people didn't provide that. So it's better. Yeah.
Can I just add a footnote to that? There is one class of interstellar chemistry codes or photodissociation regions, where there was a very extensive benchmark exercise carried out a few years ago, and the results were published.
Yeah.
And most of the codes that were compared in that workshop were actually publicly available, and still are. So that kind of code. But that, of course, doesn't include any coupling to hydrodynamics. For the chemistry itself, both the networks and the codes.
Yeah, but at least, but for this, for the, I have to mention this, for models where you include dust physics or dust chemistry, there's really not too much public. And even if you have some public code, they miss a lot of information. I mean, this same key that provided a code, which is an autos, I guess, to evolve the chemistry, but this is not including the dust. So the question is why? So yeah, we need more transparency, I guess. But when I talk to people, I mean, I try to benchmark. I did a lot of benchmark. So people like Dimitri Semenov, for instance, he was very willing to benchmark. He's into that, and other people also working in this zero D code, they are willing to benchmark, because it's also good for their own code, right? They can check if the code is working fine. And in the PDR, you're right, they did a lot of benchmark.
Yeah. Other questions?
No, that's the bottom of it.
If you have other questions,
we're going to take a 5-minute break, and then we